my kick is that gangster shit. Don't leave a scene till I run out of clips. That's it, that's it. All I kick is that gangster shit. Beef with me is like slitting your wrist. That's it, that's it. All I kick is that gangster shit. Kill you quick and I'm fucking your bitch. That's it, that's it. All I kick is that gangster shit. Don't like bad boy either, dick.
Jamal Michael Barrow, better known as Shine, was born November 8th, 1978, in the Caribbean country of Belize. His mother, Frances, is from Brooklyn, and his father, Dean, is from Belize. His father was a politician. He served time as the country's prime minister. When Shine was just 3 years old, his mother would move back to Brooklyn from Belize, leaving Shine in the care of his father. Dean, who was too busy with his political career to really be a father, so Shine spent most of his time with his aunt and his uncle. When Shine was just 8 years old, he would move to Brooklyn to live with his mom in East Flatbush while spending summers in Belize with his father. After he moved to New York, he began to develop a strong interest in the hip-hop culture. New York being the birthplace of hip-hop, it was easy for Shine to get exposed to the genre. It wasn't long before he was writing his own raps and freestyling. In 1998, while he was freestyling in a barbershop, he was discovered by hip-hop producer DJ Clark Kent, who was working on the notorious B.I.G.'s first album since his death, Born Again. He quickly took to Shine and introduced him to Puff Daddy, who would sign him right on the spot. It was reported that Shine would receive millions of dollars, 3 cars of his choice, and 2 homes just for signing the contract. This also included a 5-studio album deal. The signing would cause a small media frenzy. It would send a shockwave through the news channels. The same year, he would remix Total's song, Sitting at Home, and the following year, he would appear on 2 major albums. The first being Mace's second album on a song called From Scratch, and later, the same year, he was featured on Puff Daddy's second album on a song called Reverse. Shine was starting to make some heavy noise in the streets. Initially, fans were torn on how to react to Shine. Shine's flow was very similar to that of Biggie's, who had just passed away a few years prior. It was really weird to see Puff Daddy sign someone like Shine during this time. From the outside looking in, it looked like just another marketing scheme on Puffy's part. But Shine could actually rap. Yes, his voice was very similar to Big, but his music was a lot different. You could credit a lot of this to his background, which was very unique and gave him a very wide spectrum of content to write about.
So your pops was, I want to get this started, your pops was the deputy prime minister.
Yeah.
And he like basically just owned you, just.
Yeah, you know, it was, you know, I was a bastard child, you understand? Mm-hmm. Basically put it like he had my mom's up and that was it, you understand? So just left her there with me and just told her to find her way, you understand?
Yeah.
She found a way though.
In 1999, Shine was busy recording his debut studio album. He was also enjoying his life as a rich man, running around with celebrities of all sorts. One of those celebrities was none other than his label boss, Puff Daddy. On December 27th, 1999, Shine and Puff Daddy and his then girlfriend J-Lo were involved in a shooting incident. It would happen at a Manhattan nightclub. 3 people would get injured. Puff was charged with 4 weapons-related charges and bribing his driver to take ownership. Shine was charged with attempted murder, assault, and reckless endangerment.
Prosecutors say Combs, partying with girlfriend and actress Jennifer Lopez, got into an argument with someone. That person reportedly then threw a stack of money in Combs' face. Prosecutors then say one of Combs' associates, 19-year-old Jamal Barrow, also known as the rapper Shine, opened fire, while Combs reportedly pulled out a pistol of his own.
On Sunday evening, I went to Club New York, and under no circumstances whatsoever did I have anything to do with a shooting. I do not own a gun, nor did I possess a gun that night. I had nothing to do with a shooting in this club. I want to make this 100% clear. I had nothing to do with a shooting in this club. And I feel terrible that people were hurt that night.
This afternoon, jurors sent the judge 2 notes, one of which asked for a transcript of a phone message Combs left Wardell Fenderson, once his driver, now the prosecution's star witness. During the trial, Fenderson testified that Combs was armed the night of the shooting at Club New York and later pressured him to claim ownership of a pistol police found when they pulled over Combs' Lincoln Navigator as it fled the shooting.
and I just want to make you feel, like, comfortable, you know what I'm saying? Make your family feel comfortable.
What exactly Combs meant by that is in dispute, but the prosecution claims the rapper offered Fenderson $50,000, or a diamond ring, to take the rap for the gun. The jurors also wanted to hear a readback of testimony relating to Combs' former girlfriend, actress-singer Jennifer Lopez, who was in the Navigator when it was stopped by police. An officer testified that everyone in the SUV was ordered to put their hands on the vehicle, but Lopez walked away, saying she was going home. As she was being detained, a gun was discovered in the vehicle. At that point, a sergeant on the scene ordered everyone who was in the vehicle under arrest. The officer quotes Lopez as saying, "It's not my gun."
In the nightclub in New York shooting, but you can't talk about it because you're in court. But what was you thinking? Were you thinking, I came from nothing, I got everything, now I'm about to lose it? What was going through your mind at that point?
Man, I was just praying. From the precinct, you understand, to when I got my bail, you understand? Next day I was like, yo, I got to be in the studio, you understand? Because it was like that whole year, man, I was just getting my mind right. He was about to shoot the video for Bad Boys and all that. You understand? So I was just praying, like, God, you know where my heart is at. You know how I do. You know I ain't wrong. You understand? So just give me this chance, man. You know what I mean?
Both artists would post a bond, making media appearances during their trial. Not only were they doing interviews and talking about the case, but Shine was still in the middle of releasing his debut album. Shine wanted to title the project The Truth because that's what he felt he was saying, relating to the case, of course. Bad Boy would make the executive decision to give the album no title at all, just calling it Shine, and he would release it on September 26, 2000. The album featured guest appearances from Barrington Levy and 112 Slim, as well as production from Bad Boy in-house producers The Hitman. The album peaked at number 5 on the Billboard Top 200 and sold just under 160,000 copies in its first week. Eventually, it would achieve platinum status. The three singles from the CD were Bad Boys, Bonnie and Shine, and That's Gangster. While they were all just moderate hits, the album featured an authenticity to it that was dying in hip-hop. It was clear that Shine was about that life that he rapped about. Bad Boy hardly promoted this album at all. Around this time, Bad Boy releases were filled with featured guest artists and radio and TV commercials. Shine's project would receive neither. The only promotion for the album was appearances he did on shows like Rap City. Shine wouldn't get to enjoy the success of the album. Shine would get sentenced to 10 years in a state prison on first-degree assault for shooting his victim in the face. Shine was given 4 other sentences on all of his other charges, ranging from 2 to 7 years, but the sentences would run concurrently, meaning he would only have to serve out the 10-year total. He wouldn't be eligible for parole until he served 8 years and 7 months. As court officials took Shine away, his mother yelled that she loved him, and of course, he replied, "I love you, Ma." Puff Daddy, he would get his sentence next. He would originally get offered a plea bargain, but he would refuse it. Ultimately, it was the right choice for him because he was acquitted of every charge.
I'm just so grateful today, and my whole family. I'm just really right now, I'm just very emotional. I'm at really a loss. I'm just very emotional. I feel blessed. You know, I'm just so, you know. I'm going to talk about all that later. Right now, I just want to go and be with my kids, you know, and I'm just grateful.
What about Shine, Mr. Combs?
I'm just grateful.
Thank you, sir. I'm not famous. I don't have a publicity machine. I don't have $1 billion of insurance on my body, or any part of my body for that matter. Does that make me any less valuable?
You have a woman who shot in the face, who still has bullet fragments 2 inches from her spine. She has 2 children. She has her own business. What is she to do now? There's an issue of health coverage. I mean, what do you tell 2 children, 10 and 7? Mommy got shot in the...
This whole incident impacted a lot of lives, outside of rap even. Over 20 years later, people are still facing the repercussions of the reckless behavior that took place that night. With that being said, none of us know exactly what happened because we weren't there. The perception in hip-hop was that Puff Daddy threw his man under the bus. It would appear that Puffy had a lot more resources than Sean. Puffy, he had his own freedom to worry about, and he was his main priority. Every dollar going to a lawyer was going to go to his own. Puffy had just gotten out of court, facing a judge earlier in 2009 over an assault charge he got with an incident he had with Steve Stout. Puffy, he would go on to become a hip-hop mogul, but this incident would haunt him for a long time. It had a huge effect on him, so much so that he would change his name to P. Diddy in an attempt to rebrand. All of Shine's appeals would fail. He would begin serving his sentence at a maximum security prison, Clinton County Correctional Facility. This seemed to spell out the end of his rap career. His contract with Bad Boy was voided and he was dropped from the label. Years would pass by. We would hear very little from rapper Shine. A new wave of rappers like DMX, Eminem, and Ja Rule were dominating the rap industry. Then, what seemed out of nowhere, rapper 50 Cent took over the entire game, dominating the charts while feuding with mainstream giants. 50, he was ruthless, and he would diss anybody. During the Hot 97 freestyle, he even went at Shine. This would cause Shine to reply on a response he recorded over the phone in prison. The song is called For the Record, and it would make enough noise to strike a renewed interest in the rapper. The culture was reminded of his authenticity. Amongst those was Irv Gotti, who at the time was extremely desperate in seeking allies for Ja Rule in his feud with 50 Cent. He made a lot of noise about Shine. This would bring even more attention to him. Then, an all-out bidding war would ensue with multiple rap labels. Eventually, Shine would settle with a contract from Def Jam Records. He would receive $3 million for an album. Due to the fact he was unable to record new music while in prison, the album was largely composed of music he had recorded prior to his incarceration. The only fully recorded song from prison was the diss track he made at 50. The album was called Godfather Buried Alive, and it was released August 10, 2004. It features appearances from Kurupt, Nate Dogg, Foxy Brown, and Ashanti, with production from Kanye West, Swiss Beatz, and Just Blaze. The album debuted number 3 on the Billboard 200, with 158,000 copies being sold in just the first week. This would make Shine only the second rapper after Tupac to have an album debut in the top 10 while incarcerated. The lead single was called Jimmy Choo and featured Ashanti. It even had a music video that was in heavy rotation on BET.
Quote unquote celebrity treated when they're inside.
You dig? They call me Poe, you feel me? Like, I'm not the whole Shine thing. I have nothing to do with that. Like I said, I detached myself from all those things. Like, you know, I had to set, you know, some of my comrades straight. Like, don't even call me Shine. My name is Poe. I'm 018-3886 to them, you dig? And, you know, I don't look at myself as a material. So when I walk around, I don't...
In 2006, Shine went to court to challenge New York's application of the Son of Sam law. This had resulted in all of his assets being frozen, limiting his ability to make record deals. He and his lawyers argued that allowing Shine to make deals would enable him to pay a higher potential settlement to victims of his crime. Shine would spend the next few years of his sentence focusing on his religion, Judaism. In 2006, Shine changed his name to Moses Michael Levi. He had stated that from the age of 13, he began to identify as an Israelite after learning that his great-grandmother was from Ethiopia.
Always good to see a real nigga get out of a tight jam. You know, he paid his debt to society. You know, that's a smart move, you know what I mean? I hope they let him come home and see his family and his friends, you know what I mean? The people that he care about, you know? You know, that's important right there, you know?
How y'all feel about Shine coming home as a whole?
I can't wait. You know, that last album, Godfather Buried Alive, shit was hard. And not to mention, you know, his first albums, when he first came out, the Barrington Levy shits, some of my favorite records right there, and just everything he represented and he stood for. He handled his business like a G when he handled his business. So, you know, it is what it is. You know, he got a lot to come home to. He most definitely got the streets waiting for him. You know what I'm saying? And he most definitely could get anything he need on this side from, you know, niggas like us.
Leading up to Shine's release, there was tons of hype in the rap community. Everyone anticipated him taking over. The game needed his realness. Shine's mental may have been in a different state than what the mass assumed. Shine was finally about to get his freedom back, but he was facing a dilemma, one that many prisoners face. That's, what am I gonna do now? Shine was facing deportation upon his release. Shine and his representatives had been expecting to be intercepted by ISIS officials. Shine had deferred members of his legal team to prepare the necessary documents in an effort to deal with the situation. Dean Barrow, Shine's estranged father, would even step in. Dean tried to use his power as the prime minister to convince New York Governor David Paterson to pardon his son. October 6, 2009, Shine was released from New York state custody. Then, he was immediately taken into federal custody, where he would be attained by U.S. immigration. He would be detained in a detention facility until October 26, when he would be released to his birthplace, Belize. Shine had served more than 9 years of a 10-year sentence. He was finally free. He had not wasted his time in prison. His time was utilized by educating and finding his spiritual side. He was certain that his life had purpose. Shine was far from the mecca of hip-hop, but even a deaf man could hear fans calling for new music. Every hot rapper wanted a feature, and the record companies, they were calling left and right. L.A. Reid would fly all the way to Belize to sign Shine to Def Jam Records. The first song released was called Messiah.
I got the city on my back, pretty women in the sack, rolling in the road, six sitting on my lap.
Yeah, I heard his new stuff. What are you trying to pull here?
Just want to get your thoughts.
Shine is Shine, man, and I think that he's been away for a long time, and he's gonna refine himself very soon, man. So it's probably gonna come off a little rough around the edges at first, cause you know he's been down for a long time. But so you know, give him some space, give him some room, and let him refine the old Shine, man.
Shine would keep dropping new songs, like Roller Song, Buffalo Soldier, The Original, and The Mayor Lansky, which featured Pusha T. In 2011, Shine would be featured on Lil Wayne's highly anticipated Carter 4, which was a huge opportunity for him. Even with that, none of Shine's music was really hitting like it used to. We would see glimpses here and there, but his voice sounded a little different, and his flow hadn't developed or really stayed relevant with the current state of hip-hop. You also got a sense that Shine wasn't really interested in rapping like he used to be. In November 2010, Shine was living in Jerusalem. Having become a student, he spent most of his time learning the Torah and stated that he was spending up to 12 hours a day studying and praying. Unfortunately, even religion couldn't stop him from avoiding getting involved in some drama. After most of his new music started flopping, he began to be an easy target to the hot new rappers at the time. It was easy to go at a rapper that they can't even enter your country. He got into petty beefs with rapper The Game and Rick Ross. Shine criticized Kendrick Lamar's Good Kid, Mad City project, and Game was quick to defend Kendrick, attacking Shine on multiple songs. It was ironic because prior to this, Game had been known to praise Shine, even collaborating with him and Pharrell on the track They Don't Want None. Shine didn't like the false image that Maybach Music Rick Ross was portraying. The notorious gangster disciples have issued repeated threats to Rick Ross. The GDs, they were angered by Maybach Music Group. The rap label used their 6-point star on the album cover for the Boys Black Bar Mitzvah mixtape. Shine said the gangster disciples only would let other GDs and Jews rep that. Shine would go on to explain how Rick Ross is pretty much on his dick and that he had spent enough time with correctional officers. Shine would make even more noise when he reunited with Diddy in 2012 during Paris Fashion Week. The music industry had changed a lot since Shine got locked up and released. While he was incarcerated, he wasn't really paying attention to trends or even polishing his own flow. He was just surviving. It was difficult for Shine to stay relevant when he got out, because he couldn't visit the United States. That's where his primary market was. This, amongst other things, would make it difficult for him to network, or even progress for that matter. By 2012, it was clear that his rap career was no longer going to be financially beneficial. After living in Belize for a few years, Shine had other goals anyways. He saw the condition of his country and wanted to improve it. He thought that he could help, so he got into politics. It started in 2012 when Shine publicly endorsed Mitt Romney, who was running against Barack Obama. Shine is a tough kid from the streets who made it big, lost everything, and rebuilt his life. He's also the former leader's son, political royalty in a nation whose country's politics are always failing. He knows both sides of the struggle. While most politicians can't relate, Shine definitely can. And his political career has been no joke. He has goals to be the prime minister, and he currently holds a seat on the Belize House of Representatives. This unique position gives him diplomatic immunity, allowing him exclusive access into countries, even the United States, where he had just been deported from.
He was supposed to give a personal explanation. I would appeal to him that let not procedural protocol interfere with offering that apology to the member of Albert. I am bringing this issue to the speaker. You are not the speaker of the house. You are the prime minister. Sit down. This is the speaker of the house. Come on.
Leader of the opposition.
It turns out that rap is just a small part of Shine's story. His time in prison and his time as a politician has already equaled more than his time he spent as a rapper. His life is inspiring, no doubt. Definitely one that anyone can learn from. I'm eager to see where the rest of his life and career goes.
I just talk about the politicians that don't do what they gotta do and the powerful people that watch people suffer and die. I wanna save dark-skinned babies from going to prison and wasting their lives. Blaze TV.